Dear devotees, Advaita Ashrama welcomes you all to this special online event organized to celebrate the 125th anniversary of Prabuddha Bharat. The monthly journal of the Ramakrishna Order, a journal which was started by Swami Vivekananda himself in 1896. I do not here intend to tell about the story of Prabuddha Bharat, because that will be dealt with by other important speakers in today's program. But I would like to focus upon Swami Vivekananda's vision of an awakened India conquering the world with her spiritual message, in which Prabuddha Bharat was one of the important instruments which Swami Vivekananda had initiated. If we ask one question, how do we describe Swami Vivekananda? Among the various answers that we get, one answer comes from Swami Vivekananda himself. In a certain context, Swami Vivekananda had spoken about himself as condensed India, condensed Bharat. Swami Vivekananda was the condensed India. And when we talk about India, we have to remember that India cannot be understood unless we go to her roots, unless we touch her soul. And the soul of India lies in the eternal scientific spiritual thought system of the Vedika Sanatana Dharma. It is the eternal scientific spiritual thought system of the Vedic Sanatana Dharma which is the soul of Bharat. And Swami Vivekananda was the very incarnation of this thought system. Swami Vivekananda was the very embodiment of Bharat. And we all know that, historically speaking, India was one of the most renowned nations in the world, known for its great contributions that it had made to the world, for its prosperity and many other things. And Swami Vivekananda had very passionately spoken about Bharat at several places. In one place, Swamiji says, "The debt which the world owes to our motherland is immense. Taking country with country, there is not one race on the earth to which the world owes so much as to India." In another place, Swamiji says, "If there is any land on this earth which can lay claim to be the blessed Punya Bhumi, the land of introspection and spirituality, that is India." Still, in another place and context, Swamiji says, "From here, from India, have started the founders of religions from the most ancient times, deluging the earth again and again with pure and perennial waters of spiritual truth. From here have proceeded the tidal waves of philosophy that have covered the earth, east or west, north or south." Now, this has been the kind of contribution that India has made to the world from the most ancient times. But at the same time, we have to remember that India also has seen its regular phases of degeneration and degradation. Whenever this eternal scientific spiritual thought system of the Sanatana Dharma got overpowered by contrary systems of thought, especially materialism, whenever India faced the onslaughts of destructive foreign invasions and foreign rule, India plunged into darkness. And at every such juncture, interestingly, we find that there emerged on the scene at that time a person who came to awaken India from the darkness which had gripped her. If we go back 6 centuries before the Common Era, we find India dipped into the depths of darkness, and there emerged Buddha to awaken India. In the 8th century of the Common Era, again we find a similar situation emerging, and we find Sri Shankaracharya emerging to awaken India. Again, in the 19th century, we find a similar situation coming about, and we have Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda coming on the scene to awaken India. And in the 19th century, when we have Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda, in that life story, we find that Sri Ramakrishna commissioned Vivekananda for this very work. And Vivekananda very well knew, like all his great predecessors, that India can be awakened only by awakening her soul, only by bringing to the fore the eternal scientific spiritual thought system and making it active in the lives of the masses. That was Swami Vivekananda's method of awakening India. And Swami Vivekananda also had envisioned that once India is awakened, through India, the entire humanity can be awakened. And this was precisely what was Swami Vivekananda's plan of awakening India, and through awakening India, awakening the entire human race. In one very important lecture, Swami Vivekananda had envisioned that once more the world must be conquered by India. This is the dream of my life, Swamiji says. The world has to be conquered by India. Swamiji says that this is the dream of my life. And he says, it is not only that we must revive our own country, my idea is the conquest of the whole world by India. And he says, up India, conquer the world with your spirituality. So this was precisely what Swami Vivekananda had in his mind, his plan to awaken India spiritually, and through an awakened India, to awaken the entire human race. Even in England, in 1896, Swami Vivekananda had given voice to his mission in unmistakable terms by referring to his idea, and he says that we have to give a new civilization to the world. Now, for this work of giving a new civilization to the world, Vivekananda went to the West. He started the Vedanta movement there. He came back to India in 1897, started the Ramakrishna mission here, and in that very context, he started this great journal called Prabuddha Bharat in 1896, which was to become one of the instruments of Swami Vivekananda to not only awaken India, but also to carry the message of Indian spirituality all over the world. So this was Swamiji's vision in short, to give a new civilization to humanity, with spirituality as its basis, to spiritualize the entire human race. And this vision also became his mission. To put it in his own words, Swami Vivekananda writes to Sister Nivedita, he says, my ideal indeed can be put into few words. That is to preach unto mankind their divinity and how to make it manifest in every moment of their lives. My idea is first of all to bring out the gems of spirituality and make them popular. Now this job of bringing out the gems of spirituality and making them popular was precisely the task which was given to this monthly magazine called Prabuddha Bharata. And Prabuddha Bharata, truly speaking, was his machinery which was meant to carry India's spiritual wisdom all over the globe. And for the last 125 years, this journal has been doing this work in silence with unswerving dedication and persistence. And today we are proud to say that we are celebrating the 125th anniversary of this great magazine started by Swami Vivekananda. In today's program, we are glad, honored, and fortunate that for this milestone event, we have with us some of the most esteemed speakers to deliberate on the significance and contribution of Prabuddha Bharat. Most important of all, we have with us our dear and honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi ji, who today stands as a typical representative of Bharat's spiritual culture and civilization. A leader with a vision and unquestionable dedication. A leader who himself draws his inspiration and strength from Swami Vivekananda. Under his leadership, we all know that the country has witnessed some of the unprecedented efforts to put India back on its true trajectory of development based on India's indigenous thought system and civilization. We are also fortunate to have with us today very important messages coming from the General Secretary of the Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission, revered Swami Suviranandaji Maharaj. And then we have the message coming from the Pro-Chancellor of the Vivekananda University at Belur Math, revered Swami Atma Priyanandaji Maharaj. We have with us the message of the Assistant Secretary of the Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission, revered Swami Bodhisaranandaji Maharaj. And we have also two very well-drafted speeches coming from two well-known scholars of Swami Vivekananda, Shri Makarand Paranjpe and Shri Somnath Mukherjee. And above all, we are blessed to receive the benediction of the most revered Srimad Swami Smaranandaji Maharaj, who is the Sangha Guru, who is the President of the Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission. And we also have the message coming from revered Srimad Swami Gautamanandaji Maharaj, who is one of the Vice Presidents of the Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission. We pray today that may India be awakened by her universal scientific spiritual thought system, and through India's awakening, may the entire humanity attain to a new awakening. May Prabuddha Bharat lead to a Prabuddha Vishwa. Thank you.
Heartiest congratulations on the completion of 125 years of publication of Prabuddha Bharata, an English journal brought out by Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission. Swami Vivekananda's noble thoughts and ideals continue to bless us with the spirit of compassion towards mankind and passion towards nation building. His entire life and teachings give us the ever-relevant message of integrating our efforts and intent with national aspirations. Driven by Swamiji's ideals of youth-powered development, we are marching ahead to build a strong and self-reliant nation. Our Yuva Shakti today lays emphasis on connecting their chosen fields of activity with our national goals. Their focused efforts reflect our collective resolve to bring about social and behavioral transformation in lives of the poor and needy and fulfill hopes and aspirations of the common people. The continued publication of Prabuddha Bharata for 125 years is a testimony to the legacy of Swamiji and the richness of his teachings. May the journal continue to further the vision and philosophy of Swami Vivekananda with renewed zeal. Best wishes for the online conference organized as a part of the 125th anniversary celebrations of Prabuddha Bharata.
Namaste. It is a matter of joy that we are celebrating the 125th anniversary of Prabuddha Bharat. This is no ordinary journal. It was started by none other than Swami Vivekananda back in 1896. That too at the young age of 33. It is among the longest running English journals of the country. Prabuddha Bharat, there is a very powerful thought behind this name. Swami Vivekananda named the journal Prabuddha Bharat to manifest the spirit of our nation. He wanted to create an awakened India. Those who understand Bharat are aware that it is beyond just a political or territorial entity. Swami Vivekananda expressed this very boldly and proudly. He saw India as a cultural consciousness that had been living and breathing for centuries. An India that only emerges stronger after every challenge despite prediction to the contrary. Swami Vivekananda wanted to make India Prabuddh or awaken. He wanted to awaken the self-belief that as a nation we can aspire for greatness. Friends, Swami Vivekananda had great compassion for the poor. He truly believed that poverty was at the root of every problem. Therefore, poverty had to be removed from the nation. He gave topmost importance to Daridra Narayan. From USA, Swami Vivekananda wrote many letters. I would like to refer to the letters he wrote to the Maharaja of Mysore and Swami Ramakrishnananji. In these letters, two clear thoughts emerge about Swamiji's approach to empowering the poor. First, he wanted empowerment to be taken to the poor if the poor themselves cannot easily go to the empowerment. Second, he said about India's poor, I quote, they are to be given ideas, their eyes are to be opened to what is going on in the world around them, and then they will work out their own salvation, unquote. This is the approach with which India is moving ahead today. If the poor cannot access banks, then banks must reach the poor. That is what the Jan Dhan Yojana did. If the poor cannot access insurance, then insurance must reach the poor. This is what the Jan Suraksha Scheme did. If the poor cannot access healthcare, then we must take healthcare to the poor. This is what Ayushman Bharat Scheme did. Roads, education, electricity, and internet connectivity are being taken to the every corner of the country, especially to the poor. This is igniting aspirations among the poor. And it is these aspirations that are driving the growth of the country. Friends, Swami Vivekananda said, the remedy for weakness is not brooding over it, but thinking of strength. When we are thinking in terms of obstacles, we get buried in them. But when we think in terms of opportunities, we get the way to move forward. Take the COVID-19 global pandemic as an example. What did India do? It did not only see the problem and remain helpless. India focused on solutions. From producing PPE kits to becoming of pharmacy for the world, our country has gone from strength to strength. It has also become a source of support for the world during the crisis. India is at the forefront of developing COVID-19 vaccines. Just a few days ago, India had launched the world's largest vaccination drive. We are using this capacity to also help other nations. Friends, climate change is another obstacle that the whole world is facing. However, we did not only complain about the problem. We brought a solution in the form of the International Solar Alliance. We are also advocating greater use of renewable resources. This is the Prabuddha Bharat of Swami Vivekananda's vision being built. This is an India which is giving solution to the world's problem. Friends, Swami Vivekananda had big dreams for India because he had immense faith in India's youth. He saw India's youth as a powerhouse of skill and self-confidence. Give me 100 energetic youngsters and I shall transform India, he said. Today, we see this spirit in India's business leaders, sportspersons, technocrats, professionals, educationalists, scientists, innovators, and so many others. They push boundaries and make the impossible into possible. But how to further encourage such a spirit among our youth? In his lecture on practical Vedanta, Swami Vivekananda brings out some deep insight. He talks about overcoming setbacks and to see them as a part of the learning curve. Second thing that must be instilled in people is to be fearless and to be full of self-belief. To be fearless is the lesson we learn from Swami Vivekananda's own life too. In whatever he did, he went ahead with self-belief. He was confident about himself. He was confident that he represented an ethos that is centuries old. Friends, the thought of Swami Vivekananda are eternal, and we must always remember true immortality is to be achieved by creating something of value to the world, something that will outlive ourselves. Our Puranic stories teach us something valuable. They teach us that those who chase immortality almost never got it. But those who had the goal of serving others almost always became immortal. As Swamiji himself said, only those live who live for others. This can also be seen in Swami Vivekananda's life. He did not go out to achieve anything for himself. His heart always beat for the poor of our country. His heart always beat for the motherland which was in chains. Friends, Swami Vivekananda did not see spiritual and economic progress as mutually exclusive. Most importantly, he was against the approach where people romanticize poverty. In his lectures about practical Vedanta, he says, and I quote, "The fictitious difference between religion and the life of the world must vanish, for the Vedanta teaches oneness." unquote. Swamiji was a spiritual giant, a highly elevated soul. Yet, he did not renounce the idea of economic progress for the poor. Swamiji was a sannyasi himself. He never sought for himself a single paisa of money, but he helped raise funds to build great institutions. These institutions have fought poverty and promoted innovation. Friends, there are several such treasures from Swami Vivekananda that guide us. Prabuddha Bharat has run for 125 years, spreading Swamiji's ideas. They have built upon his vision of educating the youth and awakening the nation. It has contributed significantly towards making Swami Vivekananda thought immortal. I wish Prabuddha Bharat the very best for their future endeavors. Thank you very much.
Friends, it is indeed a great joy to celebrate the 125th anniversary of Prabuddha Bharata, a journal started by Swami Vivekananda himself in 1896. Swamiji envisaged this journal to be the mirror of India or Bharata. The complete name that he gave to the journal is Prabuddha Bharata or Awakened India. At that time, India was not yet a free country and was bound by the shackles of foreign rule. Swamiji wanted to see the nation awakened. Through the pages of Prabuddha Bharata are reflected the years of Indian freedom movement, achievement of India's independence, and thereafter its economic stability and also establishing itself as the world capital of spirituality and soft skills. Major thinkers who shaped this progress of the nation have written in the pages of Prabuddha Bharata. The writers range from Jyotirao Sarkar, the famed historian, to Carl Jung, the famous psychologist. Keeping the tradition of luminous writers, the journal has carried the thoughts of great leaders like Bal Gangadhar Tilak and C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer. Swamiji wanted Prabuddha Bharata to bring the message of Vedanta to the doorstep of one and all. And today, we are witnessing the fact that the journal has successfully done it for 125 long years and would continue to do so much after all of us would have turned into dust. This journal is one of the longest running English monthly journals in the world and the oldest English monthly journal in India. Like the journey of the nation, it represents the journey of the journal Prabuddha Bharata too has not been a smooth one. The admirers of Swamiji Maharaj in Madras started this journal, and in July 1896, the first issue of the journal rolled off to the press. In a short time, the journal became the voice of Ramakrishna movement. To quote, "To bring millions sunk in darkness to the light of the Lord," unquote. The journal missed the issue of July 1898 because of the untimely death of its prodigious editor, B.R. Rajam Iyer, who was a genius when he passed away at the age of 24, having penned the first modern Tamil novel, and his writings continue to inspire generations through the compilation Rambles in Vedanta. Swamiji, then in Almora, asked his English disciples, Captain Xavier and his wife, to revive the journal. Swamiji even wrote a poem to reawaken Prabuddha Bharata, or Awakened India, and titled it To the Awakened India. I quote a few lines from this poem. Awake, arise, and dream no more. This is the land of dreams where karma weaves unthreaded garlands with our thoughts. Be bold and face the truth. Be one with it. Let visions cease, or if you can't, dream but truer dreams, which are eternal love and service free. Mrs. and Mr. Xavier brought a second-hand printing machine from Calcutta to the hill town of Almora, and Swami Swarupananda, the second editor of the journal, ran the journal from the Thompson House in Almora town for some months. In March 1899, the office of the journal was shifted to Mayavati in Uttarakhand, an ideal place deep in the Himalayas for the pictures of Advaita Ashrama. It is staggering to imagine the monks and a few local people faithfully working in stringent financial conditions. Cold, rain, compounded with shortage of paper, ink, etc., and carrying materials on horseback from a long distance and then dispatching the journal at the equally distant post office. In 1914, a new building was constructed for the editorial office of the journal. Till the 1920s, the journal was printed at Mayavati, after which the printing was shifted to the local press. As printing technology was improving, it was felt wise to shift the printing to a modern city. Therefore, while the editorial section stayed back in Mayavati, the printing was shifted to Calcutta. It was also helpful for timely dispatch. In the early 1990s, the typesetting of the journal was computerized, and in the early 2000s, the editing process was completely computerized. The computerized library of the Prabuddha Bharata office has many rare books to its credit. In 2017, a larger building was constructed at Mayavati for the editorial office. At present, all the editing and typesetting work of the journal is done at Mayavati, and it is run off from the printers in Calcutta and circulated across the world. This is how this journal functions today. Prabuddha Bharata finds his place in prestigious indices of scholarly publications. Many philosophical ideas have been debated on the pages of this journal. Reflecting the pluralistic spirit of India, the journal carries articles, book reviews, and papers on philosophy, spirituality, culture, psychology, history, language, arts, and many other fields from the social sciences and the humanities. Most writings of Swamiji were first published in the pages of this journal. So were the writings of most of the episodes of Sri Ramakrishna and of Sister Nivedita. Many scriptural texts have been translated through the pages of this journal. Thus, this journal has been the source for numerous books published by the Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission and also other publishers. The environment of Advaita Ashram Mayavati, where the editorial office of the journal is located, provides the best atmosphere for the deep meditation in thought that the editorial team consisting of the editor and the associate editor has to do. Situated at a height of 6,400 feet above sea level, away from the nearest mountain village by 4.5 kilometers, the ashram is home to more than 80 species of birds throughout the year. The ashrama is regularly visited by various kinds of deer, civets, leopards, and the forest neighborhood hosts a horde of bears. The Nasodhya Sukta talks of darkness enveloped in darkness. This can be seen for oneself on a new moon night in Mayavati. On such a night, one can't even see one's own hands. Sound and fury has not yet reached this pristine place. With no light or sound pollution, this place, which got a paved road only in 1960s, affords such a silence that one can hear one's own heartbeat with a little concentration even during the day. Thus, every page of the journal is produced not just with linguistic or creative fineness, but out of the plunges into the deep within. However, it is quite difficult to work in such a remote location. The internet stops working every other day. There is huge snowfall twice or thrice a year. The monsoon wreaks a havoc on the ashrama every year. Everything has to be brought from afar, and most things are not available or cannot be serviced locally. Though every year things improve, it's a challenging atmosphere to work in, but the purity and sublimity of the place makes all this trouble an insignificant price to pay for such an atmosphere. The journal has maintained a rich repertoire through the hard work of a galaxy of spiritual luminaries who were its editors, like Swami Jyotishwarananda ji, Swami Ashokananda ji, Swami Pavitrananda ji, Swami Vandananda ji, Swami Adishwarananda ji, Swami Budhananda ji, Swami Bhajananda ji, and also Swami Birajananda ji and Swami Gambhirananda ji, who were editors at some point of time, later became presidents of the Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission. The current editor is the 37th editor in 125 years. This frequent change of the editors maintains the freshness and originality of the journal. This journal has been published ceaselessly, even during the two world wars, and has continued so even during the difficult times of COVID-19 pandemic. The editorial team has not shied from using the best technology and the best practices in the production of the journal. In 2010, 114 years of the journal was digitized in a searchable DVD format. Later, the entire journal has been uploaded to an open source repository so that countless seekers of knowledge could be benefited by the gems of thoughts that have been published in this journal. In an era that is witnessing a fast decline in reading habits and in-depth reading, Prabuddha Bharata continues to carry through its pages thought-provoking ideas in a syncretic endeavor from across the world. Many scholars around the world look up to this journal for quality content. Serious research is encouraged through this journal. Even today, newly discovered material hitherto unpublished continues to crown the pages of this journal. Swami Vivekananda wanted this journal to be an instrument in awakening the nation. When Swamiji named this journal, he wanted us to first have a good understanding of what Bharata or India was made up of and then to engage in the exercise of awakening it. Swamiji said, I quote, "Now my one desire is to rouse the country, the sleeping Leviathan that has lost all faith in its power and makes no response. If I can wake it up to a sense of the eternal religion, then I shall know that Sri Ramakrishna's advent and our birth are fruitful." Unquote. We pray to Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother Sarada Devi, and Swami Vivekananda that let this journal continue to awaken the nation till it attains its well-deserved place as the queen of all nations in the world. Before I wrap up, I must express our gratitude to those learned monks who have guided the destiny of Prabuddha Bharata all these years since its inception. And I would like to pray at the holy feet of Swamiji Maharaj that let all be happy, all be free from ailments, all be blessed with the vision of truth, beauty, and goodness. Let misery touch none. And fine, before I take leave of you, I must express my heartfelt gratitude to Swami Shuddhidananda ji, the present Adhyaksha of Mayavati Ashrama, for having so kindly remembered me on this occasion. Wish everyone all the best. Namaskar.
The longest night seems to be passing away. The sorest trouble seems to be coming to an end at last. The seeming corpse appears to be awaking, and a voice is coming to us. Away back where history and even tradition fails to peep into the gloom of the past, coming down from there, reflected as it were, from peak to peak of the infinite Himalaya of knowledge and of love and of work, India, this motherland of ours, a voice is coming unto us, gentle, firm, and yet unmistakable in its utterances, and is gaining volume as days pass by. And behold, the sleeper is awakening. Like a breeze from the Himalayas, it is bringing life into the almost dead bones and muscles. The lethargy is passing away, and only the blind cannot see, or the perverted will not see, that she is awakening, this motherland of ours, from her deep, long sleep. None can desist her any more. Never is she going to sleep any more. No outward powers can hold her back any more. For the infinite giant is rising to her feet.
Namaskar. My pranams to Swami Smarananda Ji, the president of the Ramakrishna Mathan Mission, and all the revered Swamis of the Ramakrishna Mission and the order that was founded by Swami Vivekananda. I would especially like to give my thanks to Swami Shuddhidananda ji and Swami Vireshananda ji for inviting me to this program. It's a great privilege to speak about the 125th anniversary of Prabuddha Bharata, which is one of the oldest running journals in India, founded by Swamiji himself. I say one of the oldest because I believe that the Vedanta Kesari was started just a year before, in 1895, just a year before the Prabuddha Bharata. And then, of course, it was known as the Brahmavadin. But I've also found out that the Theosophist was started in 1879 and is still running today. However, we all are here to talk about Prabuddha Bharata, which of course Swami Vivekananda inspired, and it had a young and dynamic editorial team in those days. B.R. Rajam Iyer especially should be remembered, who was only about 24 years old then. And after 2 years of its publication in Madras, which is now known as Chennai, from July 1896 to June 1898, unfortunately, the journal underwent a serious setback because Rajam Iyer fell ill and died at a very young age, and the July number of the journal could not be published. But then something miraculous happened. Swamiji had met this English couple called Mr. and Mrs. Sevier. Henry Sevier had been a non-commissioned officer in the British Army, and his wife, Charlotte Sevier, and he had met Swamiji in London in, I think, 1895. And the following year, they decided to accompany him back to India when he was in Europe. Swamiji was very keen to start a center in the foothills of the Himalayas, and the Seviers, at his direction, rented a cottage near Almora. Later on, they bought a beautiful tea estate called Mayavati, which is near Champavat in the hills, from where you could see a beautiful view of the snow-clad Himalayas. So when Prabuddha Bharata closed down temporarily, that is, one issue did not come out, Swamiji asked the Seviers to take charge, and Captain Sevier went to Calcutta to buy the press and transported it all the way to Almora. They had to take a train from Howrah to Kathgodam, and then the type and the printing press and all the other material was brought to Mayavati after the ashram was established there in 1899. Now, the ashram was of course called Advaita Ashram, and it's still a very great center for spiritual sadhana, as well as it runs a health center. I must say also that our own Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi ji, in his Parivrajak days, spent time at Mayavati. Anyhow, let's come back to the story of the extraordinary people who founded the Advaita Ashram as well as Prabuddha Bharata. In addition to the Seviers, we must today remember a very great devotee of Swami Vivekananda and a great disciple of his also, whose name is Swami Swarupananda ji. Now, Swarupananda's pre-monastic name was Ajay. He was called, his full name was, if I remember right, Ajay Hari Banerjee. And he was born on 8th of July 1871 in Bhavanipur in Calcutta. Now, Ajay first met Swamiji after Swamiji came back to India. You know, he had an extremely successful debut at the Parliament of World Religions in 1893, as we all know. After spending about 2 years abroad, he came back to India, and Ajay met him in April or May in 1897. In fact, we have some very interesting record of Swami Swarupananda ji from Sister Nivedita, who also came to India in 1898 for the first time and was staying in a cottage near Belur at that time, a little bit away from the monastic lodgings where Swamiji and the brother monks were located. And she tells us in her book, The Master as I Saw Him, that within a few weeks, Swamiji ordained Ajay Hari Banerjee into the sannyas order. In fact, he was ordained on the 29th of March in 1898. So his first meeting with Swamiji was about 1897 in Nilambar Mukherjee's garden house in Belur. And within a few months, Swamiji was very impressed with him. And in 1898, in March, he became Swami Swarupanandaji, who not only was the co-founder of the Advaita Ashram along with the Seviers, but also the editor of Prabuddha Bharata. And he edited Prabuddha Bharata for quite a long time, till in fact he passed away in 1906 at a very young age, before he had reached, I guess, the age of 35. In fact, it was a time when some of our great people, including Swamiji, who passed away before he was 40, they died very young. Even Sister Nivedita did not live, very much beyond, the 40s. She also died in her 40s. And Sister Nivedita, in her reminiscences, talks about Swami Swarupananda because she was going through a difficult time trying to adjust to India. And also, Swamiji was a very hard taskmaster with Nivedita. And he gave her absolutely no personal attention, which she craved for because she had followed him all the way to India, but was extremely strict as a guru can be with a disciple. And you find that Sister Nivedita started learning how to meditate under the guidance of Swami Swarupanandaji. She also learned about Hinduism and took lessons in Bangla with him. So Swami Swarupanandaji was a very remarkable young monk who had dedicated his life to the service of humanity. And it is Sister Nivedita who tells us what made him turn away from the world. And there's a very beautiful scene, reminiscent almost of the scenes that the Buddha saw as a young prince, Siddhartha, when he saw old age, when he saw disease and he saw death, and he tried to go deep into the meaning of life. So similarly, Swami Swarupananda, in his pre-monastic days as Ajay Hari Banerjee, came across one day walking through the bazaar an old woman who was picking up grains of rice, grain by grain, from the dust and dirt where her bowl of rice had been upturned by a careless passerby. And she was moaning and crying and picking up the grains of rice. And Swamiji, that is, I'm talking about Swami Swarupanandaji, he felt, what kind of a God is it who can be so cruel to the suffering of human beings? And he believed that the answer lay in trying to discover the truth behind the illusion of the phenomenal world. So when he came in contact with Swami Vivekananda, he decided to renounce the world and practice Advaita Vedanta, whereby he could find the truth behind the phenomenal world of appearances and find the truth. And I think that he told Sister Nivedita that it is our own mind which causes sorrow as well as happiness, and not the world outside. So these were remarkable people. The Seviers gave they dedicated their lives to India. They sold their property to buy the tea estate, which they then gave over to Swamiji to turn it into the Advaita Ashram. And Captain Sevier died very soon afterwards. In fact, when Swamiji was in the US, he heard the news in San Francisco that Captain Henry Sevier had died. The record of that time shows that he used to wear a dhoti and gerua sweater or a kurta on top, and he would work like an ordinary laborer in the fields of the Advaita Ashram. And later, Charlotte Sevier, his wife, whom Swamiji called Mother, a again devoted many years of her life. Not only did she help in publishing and editing the Prabuddha Bharata, which we are going to talk more about today, but she also helped to bring out the complete works of Swami Vivekananda. She also helped in the editing and the writing of his biography by the Eastern and Western disciples. She lived there until a ripe old age and then returned to England afterwards. So, in remembering the 125th anniversary of the Prabuddha Bharata, we must remember these remarkable people. I wanted to mention these people because a mark of a great leader like Swamiji is that he could inspire others. He was not like a banyan tree under whose shadow nothing else can grow. Rather, Swamiji was a great mentor and creator, inspirer of other leaders. To me, that is a mark of a great leader, a person who can produce other leaders. We can only remember Sri Ramakrishna, who produced so many sannyasis, the apostles of Ramakrishna, 12 of them, or maybe 13, and they in turn initiated and inspired thousands and thousands. And of course, when we think about Swami Vivekananda, we know that he was in some sense the moving spirit behind India's resurgence. And the title of the journal, Prabuddha Bharata, in fact means Awakened India. And we should remember that Swamiji was very fond of quoting the line, you know, from the Kathopanishad, Uttishthata Jagrata Prapya Varan Bodhata. So, you know, he was inspiring the masses after he came back to India. And in a way, Swamiji had discovered what would make India a great nation again. And it seemed to me that when he went to the United States, especially to the Columban Exhibition, of which the World's Parliament of Religions was a part, he saw the great material progress of the West. Swamiji did two remarkable things among many, many others in his life. One is, for the first time in almost 1,000 years, he took the message of India, India's wisdom, Vedanta, which he called practical Vedanta, to the West. We had not had an Indian, you might say, spiritual leader or genius, you know, take India's message abroad after, you know, the conquest of India by the Islamic invaders after the sacking of Nalanda. I think that we did not have the capability actually to take our message abroad. But after almost a gap of 1,000 years, 900, 800 years, Swamiji once again went to the world and told them about India's treasury of wisdom. And that is why many people have felt that Swamiji represents the counter-attack from the East on the West. At the same time, he was a great synthesizer. He did not think that India's genius lay in cultivating poverty. He was a great admirer of modern science and technology. He had met Tesla, you know, the great Nikola Tesla, the great scientist, and had explained to him, you know, the relationship between Akash, you know, the Akash Tattva, and the whole idea of, you know, energy. So the relationship between mass or matter and energy had been explained to Swamiji, had been explained to Nikola Tesla by Swamiji in a very succinct manner, and Tesla actually acknowledged it. So Swamiji realized that for India to become great, we have to combine our ancient wisdom, which is in the Upanishads and in the Vedas, with modern science and technology in such a way that we make India materially prosperous once again. But he also believed that the slumbering masses of India, who were in tremendous poverty, you know, had to be helped, and the depressed classes, the women, everyone had to be uplifted from poverty and backwardness. And he gave a new mantra, as it were, for India and indeed for the world, which he called practical Vedanta. Now, what does practical Vedanta mean? It means that to find spirituality, to find your true self, to find God, you don't have to turn away from nature, but you have to act in the world in such a manner, you know, that you can also progress as well as help the world. And that, in fact, became the motto of the Ramakrishna mission, as we know so well. You know, to find one's own salvation and Jagat Hitaya Cha, as Swamiji had put it so eloquently, beautifully. But here is where the last point we must remember, that it was Swamiji who taught us that spirituality is not just striving for our own liberation. Spirituality is actually serving other people and engaging with the world, and to try to uplift the consciousness of all of humanity. So in my own book on Swami Vivekananda, you know, it's right here. One of the points I made is that it is the unknown Vivekananda that still beckons to us, because his project was nothing short of a spiritual, or you might say consciousness revolution, which would change the future of the entire humanity. And remembering these words of Swamiji, Uttishtata Jagrata, which got translated into the title of Prabuddha Bharata, and he wrote a poem to Awakened India, you know, where he gave the mission statement of the journal. It's a beautiful poem which bears repetition. So when the journal was transferred from Madras to Almora in the Himalayas, this is the poem that Swamiji wrote, which beautifully symbolizes the motto of the Ramakrishna mission, Atmano Mokshartham Jagat Hitaya Cha. So let us now just look quickly at this beautiful poem. Once more awake, for sleep it was not, nor death to bring thee life anew, and rest two lotus eyes for visions, daring yet. The world in need awaits, O truth, no death for thee. Resume thy march with gentle feet that would not break the peaceful rest, even of the roadside dust that lies so low. Yet strong and steady, blissful, bold and free, awakener ever forward, speak thy stirring words. Thy home is gone, where loving hearts had brought thee up and watched with joy thy growth. But fate is strong. This is the law. All things come back to the source they sprung, their strength to renew. Then start afresh from the land of thy birth, where vast cloud-belted snows do bless and put their strength in thee for working wonders new. The heavenly river, tune thy voice to her own immortal song. Deodar shades give thee eternal peace. And above all, Himala's daughter, Uma, gentle, pure, the mother that resides in all as power and life, who works, all works and makes of one the world, whose mercy opens the gate to truth and shows the one in all, give thee untiring strength, which is infinite love. They bless thee, all the seers great, whom age nor clime can claim their own, the fathers of the race who felt the heart of truth the same, and bravely taught to man, ill-voiced or well. Their servant thou hast got the secret, 'tis but one. Then speak, O love, before thy gentle voice serene. Behold how visions melt, and fold on fold of dreams departs to void, till truth, and truth alone, in all its glory shines. And tell the world, arise, arise, and dream no more. This is the land of dreams, where karma weaves unthreaded garlands with our thoughts of flowers, sweet or noxious, and none has root or stem, being born in naught, which the softest breath of truth drives back to primal nothingness. Be bold and face the truth. Be one with it. Let visions cease, or if you cannot, dream but truer dreams, which are eternal love and service free. So we can see how in this poem Swamiji has given us the motto, not only for Prabuddha Bharata, the journal, but for awakened and resurgent India herself, which is to be bold and to find our true nature and to act in the world in such a way that we benefit not just ourselves as Indians, but all of humanity. It is this Bhadra Iccha, this noble idea or ideal with which Swamiji inspired the people of India in our darkest hour of colonial domination. And I always say it was as if Swamiji did the Pran Pratishthapana of the new deity in the pantheon of the Indian gods and goddesses. Who was this new deity? She was Bharat Mata, or Bhavani Bharati herself. And as her sons and daughters, it is our duty today to carry the torch forward and walk the path that Swamiji pointed. And I'm sure that all of us today, inspired by his words, can pledge ourselves to make India a great nation once again, not just for our own glory and pride, but for all of humankind.
What I objected to in the design for the Prabuddha Bharata was not only its tawdriness, but the crowding in of a number of figures without any purpose. A design should be simple, symbolical and condensed. I will try to make a design for Prabuddha Bharata in London and send it over to you. Whatever you do, let that be your worship for the time. Let this paper be your god for the time, and you will succeed. The cover is simply barbarous. It is awful and hideous. If it is possible, change it. Make it symbolical and simple, without human figures at all. The banyan tree does not mean awakening, nor does the hill, nor the saint, nor the European couple. The lotus is a symbol of regeneration.
ॐ नमः श्री यतिराजाय विवेकानन्दसूरये सच्चित्सुखस्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे. मै सैल्युटेशन्स् टु स्वामी विवेकानन्द, हु इस् द किङ्ग् आफ् रिनौन्सर्स् एण्ड् हि इस् अ ल्यूमिनस् सन् आफ् स्पिरिचुआलिटि and wisdom, and who is the embodiment of Satchidananda, existence absolute, knowledge absolute, and bliss absolute. When Swami Vivekananda was traveling in the West, his triumphal conquest of the Western materialism by the Indian spirituality, for nearly 4 years, he was traveling the West in America and Europe. He noticed two distinct important phenomena. One, he saw Western materialism is taking away peace and lasting joy from the lives of people. Too much of enjoyment and proclivity towards sense pleasures, these are taking away from men and women the capacity for high thinking, although science and technology developed thanks to the World War later on. Number two, he saw that Europe was poised on a volcano. He said, I saw the whole of Europe is sitting in a volcano. Unless it is quenched by the waters of spirituality from India and the East, it will burst any moment. And soon followed the terrible World War II. He said, therefore, the time has come for India to contribute the thought current to the world. He analyzed the history of nations, the world history, with particular reference to India, and his genius of analysis as well as synthesis, Swami Vivekananda came up with a fantastic conclusion, which was, just like every limb in the human body has a role to play, in this comity of nations, every nation has a specific role and a mission, and the mission of India is a spiritual awakening of the entire humanity. He saw in the life of his divine guru Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, his struggle to attain the infinite, as Sri Aurobindo beautifully put it, Ramakrishna seized the kingdom of God with violence. He stormed the citadel of God, and how many kinds of experiences, samadhis, spiritual realizations, he accumulated tremendous spiritual power. And Swami Vivekananda said, Sri Ramakrishna awakened the Kula Kundalini, which is the cosmic spiritual consciousness. And the awakening of the cosmic spiritual consciousness symbolized by the Kundalini, the cosmic Kundalini, makes it extremely propitious for the individual Kundalinis of the consciousness of people to be awakened. So he realized the awakening of the spiritual consciousness of the entire humanity is the one purpose for which the Lord has preserved India through centuries and millennia of vicissitudes and misfortunes. India had held on to its spiritual strength. Hundreds of thousands of rishis and seers and sages, men of God, renounced everything for realizing that one ideal of a spiritual realization. Swamiji's own words, he says, a mission has been given to us, which is to conserve, to preserve, to accumulate, as it were, into a dynamo, all the spiritual energy of the race. And that concentrated energy is to pour forth in a deluge on the world whenever the circumstances are propitious. This was Swami Vivekananda's vision, and he clearly saw India's role. The Indians need to be equipped for that. This was his next mission. We are called upon in India to contribute to the awakening of the spiritual consciousness of the entire humanity, which Swami Vivekananda clearly saw as if in a vision. And he also saw that Indians themselves are not aware of their great heritage, spiritual heritage. Thanks to repeated foreign invasion and 1,000 years of foreign rule, the backbone of our country, which is spirituality, religion, inwardness, contemplation, this has been broken. Not fully broken, but about to be broken. Swami Vivekananda found that this has to be stopped. Indians should be reawakened to their own spiritual heritage. They should be awakened from the deep slumber in which they were. and for which he said, the idea should be brought back from the ancient books. The Vedanta which was there, practiced by the rishis and munis in the forests and the caves in the Himalayas, should be brought to the marketplace and transform the qualities of life of common men and women. Is Vedanta or spirituality only for spiritual realization or salvation? Or can Vedanta be a powerful force for social transformation, for the material advancement, intellectual progress, and a spiritual emancipation? Swami Vivekananda clearly saw that Vedanta is capable of solving the problems of men and women wherever they are, in all spheres, intellectually, spiritually, morally, aesthetically, and even materially. For which he said, we need to propagate this message as culled from the ancient texts. The easiest, he thought, was to start a magazine or a journal. He called his magazine very strangely Prabuddha Bharata. Prabuddha means awakened. Bharata is Bharatavarsha or India. Why India? That was because Swamiji did not talk about India in the chauvinistic, narrow, patriotic impulse, but he knew India was a preserver, as we just now said, to preserve, to conserve, to accumulate, as it were, in the dynamo, all the spiritual energy of entire humanity, millennia upon millennia, and this concentrated spiritual energy will burst forth when the time is propitious. So he started a monthly. In fact, Swami Vivekananda said, I want to start a daily magazine in vernacular in Bengali. Simultaneously, he started Udbodhan in the vernacular in Bengali and in English, because English he found the international language. Because Vedanta is not confined only to India and to Sanskrit knowing people. Vedanta is universal and Vedanta is timeless. These are the two qualities of science. Science is universal and science is timeless. Anybody, anywhere, at any time, experimenting along the same lines, using the same protocol, same procedure, will have to arrive at the same result. This is the replicability of science. Swami Vivekananda saw that Vedanta is a spiritual science which has been developed in India over millennia upon millennia, and now this has to be propagated in the modern language and in the modern idiom. It was a very, very difficult task. He writes in a famous letter to Alasinga Perumal, his dear Madras disciple, to put Hindu ideas into English and make out of dry philosophy, intricate mythology, queer, startling psychology, a religion which shall be simple, easy, popular, at the same time meet the requirement of the highest minds, is a task only those can understand who have attempted it. The dry, abstract Advaita should become living, poetic in everyday life. Out of hopelessly intricate mythology must come concrete moral forms. Out of bewildering yogism must come the most scientific and practical psychology. And all this should be put in a form that even a child may be able to grasp it. And that is my life's work. This is Swami Vivekananda defining his own life's work and mission. So he put his disciples, brother disciples, the followers, admirers, to propagating this great message of Vedanta. 100,000 men and women, he said, will go over the length and breadth of the world preaching the gospel of equality, gospel of spirituality, and gospel of emancipation, based upon the ancient scriptures but put in the modern idiom. Purana is a word which is very common with regard to the supreme reality in our scriptures. Purana means pura api nava. This is the definition of the great commentator Shankaracharya. Although it is ever ancient, it is ever new. So this truth, although it is very ancient, is always new because it is renewed. The renewal of this truth of Vedanta through this magazine called Prabuddha Bharata, and it is 125 years since this great journal started by Swami Vivekananda has been seeing the light of day month after month uninterruptedly. Very rarely in the history of journalism in the world you will find a magazine, a spiritual magazine, a Vedanta magazine, a religious magazine, a metaphysical magazine going on uninterruptedly and going strong. Many people think that these magazines talking about high philosophy will not be understood by people. You should popularize it by making it simplistic. No. Give them the highest thought. Every human being is capable of absorbing the highest. We give them not the highest but something lower. Raise the level of everybody. Swami Vivekananda also said, when a question was asked in the West, a philosophical club at Harvard, they asked him, what is your Vedantic idea of civilization? Swamiji immediately answered, that society is the greatest when the highest truths become the practical. Highest truths can be practicalized, can be experimented with, can be practiced in every day, and all peoples all over the globe can practice these Vedantic truths. He also talked about two kinds of literature. The kind of literature produced by the Prabuddha Bharata over 125 years belongs to the category of what Swami Vivekananda called realizing the ideal as contradistinguished with idealizing the real. The modern magazines which we usually come across, which are very popular, hundreds of thousands of subscribers, usually, there are exceptions of course, cater to idealizing the real. You describe what actually happens in society, all the bad things of society, all the vulgar things of society you portray in the name of showing what is real. It's a mirror of society. Swami Vivekananda said, there is another kind of literature which realizes the ideal. The ideal is too high that can be realized. And that kind of literature, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, the Bible, the Quran, all the various religious texts of the prophets and saints of all religions, Guru Nanak, Mirabai, all these are literature which realize the ideal. And such literature is timeless, because it embodies the timeless principles, the values of the highest truths of God, of human soul, human destiny, realization, which immediately the human mind responds. And Swami Vivekananda also saw that the doctrines of the church, either in India or abroad, in the Western world, the doctrines and dogmas and creeds and belief systems and crystallized traditions have completely killed the spirit of religion. He wrote in a letter to E.T. Sturdy, religions of the world have become lifeless mockeries. What the world now wants is character, which is one of boundless love, where every word will tell like thunderbolt. And therefore, Swami Vivekananda found freedom at every level. Freedom from misery, freedom from ignorance, freedom from poverty, and freedom from spiritual slavery. slavery to the senses, at every point, freedom, oh freedom, freedom, oh freedom is the song of the soul. He said, therefore, each soul is potentially divine. The goal is to manifest this divinity within by controlling nature external and internal. Do this either by work or worship or philosophy or psychic control, by one or more or all of these, and be free. This is the whole of religion. Doctrines and dogmas or rituals or temples or farms or books are secondary details. He saw that the church and doctrines are losing their force. People are losing faith in religion and spirituality. Therefore, he said, under the sledgehammer blows of modern scientific discoveries, the doctrines of the church are pulverizing like pieces of porcelain. The real religion and spirituality should be rediscovered, re-enunciated, and revivified, for which he created this wonderful medium called the Prabuddha Bharata, which has been serving humanity across the globe for 125 years non-stop. And the journey of this magazine, the Dharma Chakra Pravartana, which the great leader Swami Vivekananda did, will go on unimpeded. Swami Vivekananda himself prophesied for 1,500 years. Glory to Prabuddha Bharata, Jayatu Vivekananda.
During the First World War, there was a critical paper shortage and not enough paper could be found to print Prabuddha Bharata. The magazine was about to be discontinued. Swami Abhayananda, Bharat Maharaj, was then in Mayavati. He walked about 80 kilometers to Tanakpur and then traveled by train to Lucknow. He bought paper there, then returned to Tanakpur by train. He put the paper on the back of the mule and walked back another 80 kilometers to Mayavati.
At the outset, I offer my pranams to revered Swami Suddhidanandaji Maharaj, Adhyaksha Advaita Ashrama, for allowing me to speak on Prabuddha Bharata, the timeless magazine. My namaskar and pranams to all the eminent speakers and the members of the audience. It's a great moment for us today when this noble magazine, Prabuddha Bharata, has stepped into its 125th year of publication. Such a rare milestone surely calls for a relook at its glorious past. For it is in there where we shall find the greatest motivation to move forward and achieve newer milestones. Let us begin at how Swamiji first came up with the ideas for promoting magazines to assist his mission. It was in the middle of the year 1894. Swamiji was yet to attend the Green Acre Conference at Elliott in Maine. For there he will be speaking first before the Western audience his message of Vedanta. A little before appearing at the Green Acre, in early July, he writes to Alasinga Perumal in Madras, "Start the journal. I will send you money from time to time." We must remember, till the end of 1894, the talks and speeches of Swamiji were mostly focused on India, her religion and people. Since the late January 1895, he first wholeheartedly began to teach the message of Vedanta, making New York City his center. After teaching Vedanta for about 5 months, in May 1895, Swamiji again wrote to Alasinghe Perumal, "Now I am bent upon starting the journal." He then drew the lines to be followed in this regard. It must not be flippant, but steady, calm, and high-toned. He assured Alasinghe, "I will send you money, do not fear work. I will get you many subscribers here. I will write articles myself and get articles written from time to time by American writers. You get hold of a band of fine writers." This had been the story of Brahmabadin, which first appeared from Madras in September 1895. It ran for about 20 years and enjoyed raving reviews ever since the appearance of its first issue. I must tell here, if one looks for the early history of the Ramakrishna order, there is no better source than the Brahmabadin. But despite such success, Swamiji soon failed for another magazine, and this led to the birth of Prabuddha Bharata. Pointing out that profuse use of Sanskrit may benefit the Hindu as well as Western Sanskrit scholars, Swamiji reminded Alasinghe, "What does the average Western man know of your Hindu philosophy? Let only one article be scholarly, if you like. The rest ought to be devoid of all Sanskrit terms and written in a very light style." In some of his other letters, we also find references to such stiffness of language in the Brahmabadin. Now, footsteps of Prabuddha Bharata is here in what Swamiji writes to Dr. Nanjula Rao in mid-April 1896. He writes to Nanjula Rao, "I received your note this morning. As I am sailing for England tomorrow, I can only write a few hearty lines. I have every sympathy with your proposed magazine for boys and will do my best to help it on." Then he elaborated his plan to Nanjunda Rao. "You ought to make it independent, following the same lines as the Brahmabadin, only making the style and matter much more popular. As for example, there is a great chance, much more than you ever dream of, for those wonderful stories scattered all over the Sanskrit literature to be rewritten and made popular. That should be the one great feature of your journal. I will write stories, as many as I can, when time permits. Avoid all attempts to make the journal scholarly. The Brahmabadin stands for that. And it will slowly make its way all over the world, I am sure. Use the simplest language possible and you will succeed. Don't make it metaphysical at all, as no business part keep it wholly in your hand. This letter shows that for the second journal from Madras, Swamiji depended more on Dr. Nanjunda Rao. But he was not alone. Dr. Nanjunda Rao had with him other disciples of Madras to carry on the project. Leading among them was Singaravelu Mudaliar, more popularly known as Kidi. He was the manager of the Prabuddha Bharata in the first 2 years during this period. And had Rajam Iyer with him as the editor. Let us see who exactly these two men were who so earnestly had involved themselves in bringing out the Prabuddha Bharata. Besides being a successful physician and the chief medical officer of the city of Madras, Dr. Nanjunda Rao had time and inclinations for philanthropic works too. Singaravelu Mudaliar was a brilliant professor of mathematics at the Madras University and considered by many as a mathematical genius. Sometime before the last quarter of 1901, when Singaravelu Mudaliar felt that his end was near, he withdrew himself from everything and came to live cheerfully in the old office of the Prabuddha Bharata, where in the same year he breathed his last in late September. At that time, Kidi was only 46. The third and most notable contributor in the early phase of the Prabuddha Bharata had been B.R. Rajam Iyer. This extremely short-lived man became immortal as the legendary editor of the magazine. He was a graduate from the Madras Christian College and authored one of the earliest Tamil novels between 1893 and 1895, which still is considered as a milestone in Tamil literature. But his spiritual quest took him away from fictional writings. We must remember these three men were drawn to Swami Vivekananda far before he went to the West. Eyewitness report confirms that it had been Swamiji's instant association which radically changed the lives of Singaravelu Mudaliar and B.R. Rajam Iyer. And led them to renounce worldly affairs and devoted them to work for him. Ever since its first number, the Prabuddha Bharata earned admiring reviews in newspapers and journals. Here I may instance only three. When the first number came out in June 1896, the Indian Mirror wrote, "The first number of the Prabuddha Bharata or Awakened India is out. Universalism is the creed of the new journal. The editor says, though an organ of the Hindu religion, the Prabuddha Bharata will have no quarrel with any other religion. For really speaking, all religions are simply different phases of the same truth, different methods of approaching God. What humanity is to man, what existence is to living beings, Vedantism is to religions." The whole has no quarrel with the part. The Maharatta of Pune wrote, "We have received a monthly called the Prabuddha Bharata or Awakened India, published in the benighted presidency of Madras. The general get-up of the magazine is sufficiently attractive. A kind of stirring earnestness pervades every page of Awakened India. Even an Anglo-Indian paper like the Madras Mails wrote, the Prabuddha Bharata or Awakened India, a monthly magazine conducted in English, is devoted to the spread of doctrines of Hindu religion and philosophy. The first number, which is now issued to the public, contains a number of interesting contributions. Such brilliant, interesting contributions, of which two are from the pen of Swami Vivekananda. But despite such brilliant men in background and accompanied by other ardent disciples of Swami Vivekananda, no more than 24 monthly issues could be published in its first phase. The writing titled Farewell in the June 88 number of the Prabuddha Bharata reads, we are forced to stop the journal with this issue, as we find the loss sustained in the premature death of our editor, B.R. Rajam Iyer, irreparable. Two reasons were offered for such unfortunate decision. First, referring to Rajam Iyer, it was mentioned that except the few contributions and the extracts, all the articles were written by him, some under should names. The second reason, referring again to Rajam Iyer, tells, if the articles were pleasing and edifying in a high degree, it was because the writer had himself some realization of the truth. Rajam Iyer was only 26 when he died. His death in May 1898 brought an immediate end to the Prabuddha Bharata after the June 1898 number. In May 1898, Swamiji was in Almora. When he received the news of Rajam Iyer's death, he was greatly shocked. But when he knew that the Prabuddha Bharata will be stopped, he decided to revive it forthwith. For at that time, the magazine was having more than 3,000 subscribers. And perhaps Swamiji decided to make it a mouthpiece of his newly established mission too. In Almora, he had with him Captain and Mrs. Xavier, his two earnest English disciples, who came with him from England to involve them in his work. Besides, Swamiji had for long a wish to open a center in the Himalayas. So he first decided to revive and run the journal from Almora till a new center is opened in the Himalaya. According to his plan, things began to move fast. The office of the Prabuddha Bharata was transferred from Madras to Thompson House in Almora. When it was shifted, Mr. and Mrs. Xavier were temporarily living at the Thompson House. Soon, the printing press and other essential materials were brought from Calcutta. Swami Swarupananda began working as the new editor. He had early experience of co-editing the Dawn magazine in Calcutta. Captain Xavier took over the responsibility as the manager of the magazine and bore all the initial expenditure. But things were not as easy as I say before you. For if we just think of the task of taking all those packing cases from Calcutta, containing everything needed to print the magazine at Almora, a place which had only a long and primitive road link with the nearest railhead. And after that, publishing the magazine within a month, we may have some idea of what the task really was. The editorial in the revived number of the Prabuddha Bharata of August 1898 reads, Prabuddha Bharata comes to its readers this month in a new garb. On the demise of its gifted editor, it died a natural death. But now, like a new phoenix emerging from its own ashes, it returns to the world after but a brief suspension of activity. This editorial had two clear pledges. First, the magazine would not deviate from the lines as had been followed before, except some essential changes. And second, Swami Vivekananda would remain as the head of all those working for the journal. But the magazine had not remained at Almora for long. Soon it went to a new place in the hills, 50 miles east of Almora, at a height of 6,800 feet above the sea level. This new place, renamed as Mayavati, became the center of the Ramakrishna order and sheltered the Advaita Ashrama, which officially came into existence on 19th March 1899, on the day of Sri Ramakrishna's birth anniversary. The press was moved there forthwith. The nearest railway station at Tanakpur stands 60 miles off from Mayavati, requiring a four-day journey on horseback in those days. Three buildings were already there within the newly acquired property, and with additions and alterations, they became ready for use. Within them were housed the ashrama where the monastic inmates lived and worked. On the upper floor, downstairs on one side, was the sitting room with the fireplace, and on the other was the press and bookbinding department. The sitting room additionally served as the Prabuddha Bharata office, as well as the dining room. The work had continued in this way for long, till the Prabuddha Bharata press and office moved to its new building opposite to the main ashram in April 1914. Even in 1910, there was only a double-crowned hand press for turning out not only the Prabuddha Bharata, but also other printing works. The magazine had a salaried composer. The monastic workers were few. In fact, in more than one winter, when there was usually more work, there were only three to manage the entire work of the ashrama. This arrangement continued till 1923, when, to improve the printing and quality of the journal, as well as to ensure timely delivery to the subscribers, changes became necessary. Therefore, leaving the editorial section at Mayavati, the publication work was shifted to Calcutta. The pages of the magazines were also increased to 50 by adding 8 more to the earlier issues. Till his untimely death in 1906, Swami Swarupananda edited the magazine with extreme efficiency. Captain Xavier, the first manager of the magazine, had breathed his last earlier in 1900. During the early years of running the journal from a remote hilltop, things frequently became extremely adverse. It had always been the great mother of Mayavati, Mrs. Xavier, who stood as a steady recourse. A most crucial stage had been when Mrs. Xavier had none else but the brahmacharis to carry on the entire work. At this time, Swami Virajananda was asked by the Mott to take over the dual charge of the president of the Advaita Ashram as well as the editor of the Prabuddha Bharata. For 7 long years, he managed this responsibility. During this time, with great support from Mrs. Xavier, the first edition of Swamiji's complete works was brought out in 1907. So also was the first volume of Swamiji's biography in 1913. During this early period, Sister Nivedita also contributed much to the magazine. After the death of Swami Swarupananda, it had been Nivedita who wrote most of the occasional notes in the Prabuddha Bharata, till she remained no more. For this, at times, she even had to leave at Mayavati as the guest of Mrs. Xavier. Prabuddha Bharata has never been in dearth of highly erudite writings, which always have in background the monastic members of the order as well as the distinguished scholars around the globe. During this long period, over a century and a quarter, innumerous leading contributors have enriched the magazine on various fields. This leaves us with an obvious impact of wonder. But why? Why so many great people at different times felt inclined to write for the Prabuddha Bharata? And more so, their efforts were hardly for any worldly rewards? Here lies the timelessness of this magazine, for it radiates the life and message of Swami Vivekananda and his dreams too. And this never fails to inspire people who actively involve themselves in running this magazine to percolate and proliferate the Swami's noble message and dreams to every corner of the globe, and thereby unite all with an unique spiritual awareness. Before I conclude, I would like to say that Swami Vivekananda never dreamed of anything unachievable, nor he planned anything unconnected with his broad scheme of things. The magazine he inspired also qualify these merits. We may remember it had been the Brahmavadin which first carried the gospel of Sri Ramakrishna to the western shore and made Professor Max Müller to ask for more of his guru from Swami Vivekananda. And we know rest is history. Similarly, almost all the Indian luminaries in religion and philosophy, literature, arts and culture, science and technology, history and sociology have for long made it a point to write in the Prabuddha Bharata. So also is true for countless contributors around the globe, missing no continent. Therefore, if we list all the names of the contributors in the last 1500 numbers of the Prabuddha Bharata and notionally connect the places of their origins with a line, we shall get nothing less than the atlas of human thoughts and ideas during the last 125 years. We all are confident that Prabuddha Bharata, while disseminating the life and message of Swami Vivekananda, will always be shining with the best of human thoughts and excellence. And it is as much the responsibility of the Ramakrishna Order as the general people in our vast country, and surely even beyond, to make it possible. Namaskar to all again.
The Vedanta system begins with tremendous pessimism and ends with real optimism. We deny the sense optimism, but assert the real optimism of super sensuous. Real happiness is not in the sense, but above the senses, and it is in every man.
Dear friends, I spent about 36 years of a monastic life in various capacities at Advaita Ashrama, both at Mayavati and Calcutta. Mayavati is nestled at the foothills of the Himalayas. This place is to me a Devabhumi, a Shangri-La, the earthly Eden of universal wisdom and ineffable peace. Even a faint smell of worldliness does not dare to penetrate these Himalayan heights. Rightly it has been said as Devatatma Himalaya, Himalayas ensouled in divinity. Prabuddha Bharata has stepped into its 125th year, marking it the longest running monthly English magazine in India. Some of the greatest minds of India and the world have contributed articles to this. Over the years, Prabuddha Bharata has inspired and shaped the thinking of many. At one time, Mahatma Gandhi used to eagerly wait for the journal. Dr. S. Radhakrishnan used to read every issue of this journal with great interest. Prabuddha Bharata is yet in the initial stage of unfolding itself, for as long as mankind seeks truth, this journal will fulfill the purpose it is meant for. Because it derives its sustenance from the infinite world of consciousness, wherein is the source of all blessedness and peace. It is Swami Vivekananda's greatness that he started 3 periodicals even during his own lifetime: Brahmavadi and Prabuddhavarta in English and Udbodhan in Bengali. It is difficult to ascertain exactly when Swamiji first conceived the idea of publishing journals, but we can assume that from the time he resolved to disseminate Sri Ramakrishna's life and message, he must have thought of establishing periodicals for the purpose. Even before going to the West, he had seen how religious movements were rising all over India and what an impetus journals and dailies gave to those movements. He also understood that the enthusiasm he received from the public would die down if the same was not channeled through an organization and a mouthpiece of its own. When Swamiji was at the height of his glory in America, he wrote to Alasinghe Perumal to start the journal, for which he will send articles from time to time and the money to publish it. Alasinghe Perumal holds an important place in the annals of Ramakrishna movement. It was he who persuaded Swamiji to represent Hinduism in the Parliament of Religions and collected money for his going to America. The first magazine that was started was Brahmavadin in Chennai. When the Brahmavadin was only 10 months old, another journal called Prabuddha Bharata or The Awakened India was published. We should remember that Prabuddha Bharata was not a competitor of Brahmavadin. Swamiji wanted that Brahmavadin should be for scholars and elders, whereas the Prabuddha Bharata should be started for bringing the message of Vedanta to the general public. Mr. B.R. Rajam Iyer, the first editor of Prabuddha Bharata, was a graduate and a talented young man of 24. The success which the Prabuddha Bharata achieved within 1 year was simply phenomenal. The extraordinary popularity of the magazine was due to the beautiful interpretation of Vedanta. However, the magazine had to be shifted to Almora and then to Mayawati after the untimely passing away of Mr. Rajam Iyer. A monastery can be started anywhere, be it in a cave or in a dense forest. But to start a publication department on the dizzy heights of the Himalayas was a daunting task. It was no mean achievement to keep the monthly magazine running for over 125 years, in spite of the difficulties in conducting the publication work in the midst of the Himalayan jungles, situated at an altitude of 6,500 feet above sea level. It is staggering to imagine how monks worked faithfully even in stringent financial conditions. Cold, rain and snow, compounded with shortage of paper, ink, etc., and carrying materials on horseback from a long distance, and then dispatching the journal at the equally distant post offices. Mayavati became a home to Prabuddha Bharata and Advaita Ashrama. The motto of the journal was kept, "Arise, awake, and stop not till the goal is reached," an Upanishadic dictum from Kathopanishad. This inspirational shloka was Swami Vivekananda's message to the world to get out of its hypnotized state of mind. The dictum was meant as a call to his countrymen to awaken their sleeping soul and propagate the message of peace and blessings to the world. On 24th April 1897, Vivekananda wrote a letter to Sarala Ghosha. In that letter, he stressed giving the public only positive education because of his belief that negative thoughts weaken men. In that letter, he also reiterated his strength giving words, "Arise, awake, and stop not till the goal is reached." Vivekananda quoted this shloka in several lectures and discourses. In a lecture delivered on 12 November 1896 at Lahore, he said, "Therefore, young men of Lahore, raise once more that mighty banner of Advaita, for on no other ground can you have that wonderful love until you see that the same Lord is present everywhere. Unfurl that banner of love, arise, awake, and stop not till the goal is reached. Arise, arise once more, for nothing can be done without renunciation." According to Sister Christine, Vivekananda wanted to see men striving to find the Supreme. In her reminiscences, Sister Christine writes, "All else might be false. This alone was true. He realized it. After his own great realization, life held out one purpose, to give the message with which he was entrusted, to point out the path and to help others on the road to the same supreme goal. When I joined Advaita Ashrama, I was asked to read handset proofs of Prabuddha Bharata. For many years, the journal printers used to print our magazine. They had linotype machine. It was a hot metal typesetting system to set type, especially small size body text for newspapers and magazines. The press provided proofs on rough newsprint paper. It was very difficult to read them. However, with the advent of computers, the typing of manuscripts and page makeup for Prabuddha Bharata came to be computerized from the September 1993 issue. The first issue we brought out was on the occasion of the centenary of Swami Vivekananda's participation in the Parliament of Religions. The printing was done in an offset press in Calcutta. In April 1996, a computer with laser printer was installed at Mayavati for composing and layout, but the printing was done in Calcutta. Later, we brought out special issues to mark special occasions like centenary of Prabuddha Bharata in 1995, centenary of Swami Vivekananda's return from the West in 1997, centenary of the founding of Ramakrishna Mission in 1997, centenary of Advaita Ashrama Mayavati in 1999. Besides this, other special issues were brought out from time to time. To celebrate the 150th birth anniversary of Sri Ramakrishna, we brought out one anthology from the old issues of Prabuddha Bharata entitled A Bridge to Eternity, and the subtitle was kept Sri Ramakrishna and His Monastic Order. Another anthology containing some of the outstanding articles published during the last 100 years was brought out in connection with the centenary of Prabuddha Bharata under the title Art, Culture and Spirituality in 1997. These precious articles would have been lost to the coming generations had they remained only in the back numbers of the journal. However, well bound and preserved, in the year 2010, we brought out a DVD which contains all the issues of Prabuddha Bharata from its inception till December 2009 in a digital format. I had the privilege to construct a spacious building which now houses the Prabuddha Bharata editorial office and a big library meant for it. It was inaugurated on 22nd October 2017. The biggest contribution of Prabuddha Bharata Press has made it the publication of the complete works of Swami Vivekananda, Authentic and Comprehensive Life of Vivekananda by His Eastern and Western Disciples, Swamiji's Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Lectures from Kolamo to Almora, and Bhagavad Gita with English translation by Swami Swarupananda. So all these books were brought out from Prabuddha Bharata Press. Through the pages of Prabuddha Bharata, the message of Sri Ramakrishna, Vivekananda and Vedanta has gone into the hearts of millions of people. In 1924, the life of Sri Ramakrishna by Swami Nikhilananda was published. It was followed by two important books on life of Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda by Roma Rola. Many scriptural texts like Vivek Chudami, Aparokshana Bhuti, Uddhava Gita, Ashtavakra Samhita were translated by our monks and then serialized in the Prabuddha Bharata. Later, these treatises were brought out in book form and are available till date. Similarly, Brahma Sutras, according to Shankara and Ramanuja by Swami Vireshwaranji Maharaj, were also serialized in this important organ of the mission and later published in book form. When I was manager of Advaita Ashram, I remember one day one Italian gentleman came and placed order for 700 copies each of the Brahma Sutras by Shankaracharya and Ramanujacharya. In those days, we used to sell 500 copies of each in a year. I was surprised. How come this man is purchasing 700 copies each of this difficult book? I frankly asked him whether he had read Bhagavad Gita and the Upanishads, because without sufficient knowledge of the Upanishads and the Gita, it is hard to understand Brahma Sutras. When he said no, then I asked him what he was going to do with these books. He said that these books were prescribed as textbooks in some American universities, and he has to supply these books to them. Likewise, Some of the Upanishads published by us are being taught in different universities in India and elsewhere. These are considered as authentic and reliable. Swami Vivekananda wanted to make Advaita Ashrama the center for diffusing Vedanta teachings. This function, right from the inception, is being discharged through this magazine and other publications in an admirable manner. Many monks who worked at one time or the other in Advaita Ashrama Mayavati were sent abroad to take up the work of preaching Vedanta in the West. Special mention may be made of Swamis Ashokananda, Nikhilananda, Raghavananda, Madhavananda, Nishreshananda, Vandananda, Adishwarananda, Chetanananda, and many others. Swamiji appreciated the old age tradition of renunciation and pursuit of spiritual realization. Many rishis from time immemorial immersed themselves in the infinite and turned their backs on the finite. He saw that this needed correction. Our incarnations like Rama, Krishna, Shankaracharya, Chaitanya took upon the task of helping mankind to get enlightenment. Swamiji knew that India needed some of the practicality of the West and that the West needed the spirituality of the East. As a world teacher of both East and West, Swamiji knew that meditation and realization must be put to practical use for the relief of the sufferings of the world. When he attained Nirvikalpa Samadhi, Sri Ramakrishna said, "Now you know all, but this knowledge will be locked in a chest, and I will have the key. Not till you have done my work will you have it again." Prabuddha Bharata took up Swamiji's mission forward and introduced Advaita Vedanta. It published articles on the immortality of the soul and on the oneness of the soul with God. It preached the law of karma and reincarnation as applied to the apparent self and the truth that religion and science are not really opposed to one another, but are actually seeking the same goal. Prabuddha Bharata is urging its readers not to be content with mere verbal theories about God, but to translate theories into practice and actually realize God in experience here and now. It stresses harmony of four yogas, harmony of different religions, and harmony of East and West. Through its articles, Prabuddha Bharata is asserting that all the stages of man's spiritual evolution as Dvaita, Vishishta Dvaita, and Advaita are not mutually conflicting as was supposed to be in the past, but complementary to one another. All cults forming the core of world religions can be accommodated within this framework. It articulates Swamiji's dictum, "His soul is potentially divine," and all the sadhanas of karma, bhakti, yoga, and jnana are meant for its actualization. It stresses there is absolutely no need for fanatical quarrels or religion. They are all due to ignorance and must be treated as a disease. Hundreds of articles have appeared in the pages of Prabuddha Bharata on the harmony of religions. I wish very much this journal started by Swamiji with a special purpose inspires countless spiritual seekers in the years to come. In the end, I thank Swami Shuddhidanandaji, the Adhyaksha of Advaita Ashrama, for giving me a chance to share my sentiments with you all. Thank you.
I am happy to know that Prabuddha Bharata is celebrating its 125th anniversary. Through this journal, Swami Vivekananda wanted to spread the message of India's spiritual wisdom all over the world. I pray to the Holy Trio for Prabuddha Bharata's success in fulfilling this exhibition.
ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः. माय डियर स्वामी शुद्धिदानंद, माय डियर मेंबर्स ऑफ द 125th ईयर प्रबुद्ध भारत सेलिब्रेशन कमिटी एंड माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, I am glad that you are conducting an online program on the occasion of the 125th year of Prabuddha Bharata publication. Prabuddha Bharata, as all of us know, stands for Awakened India. It is a journal connected with an epochal phenomenon which has as its initiator the messenger of the new age, Swami Vivekananda. The phenomenon is the awakening of India, which was a mighty nation whose potentialities lay yet dormant. This awakening started with the birth of Sri Ramakrishna and was carried forward by Swami Vivekananda for the sake of the country's well-being and for the well-being of the whole world. Swami Vivekananda often said that India needs the advancement of science and society of the West. The West also needs the advancement of universal morality, religion and spirituality from India. Chosen by his master Sri Ramakrishna himself and equipped with supreme spiritual realization and with gifts of the head and heart, Swami Vivekananda rose to live up to the task bequeathed to him by his master. He first identified the problems of the nation, then thought out the solutions, and finally worked out the grand plan of rejuvenation. Ignorance of modern developments, neglect of women, exploitation of the masses, and lack of strength were important problems that India faced. She urgently needed man-making education of the masses, upliftment of women, raising of the standard of living of the masses, and building up of character of the whole nation as the solution. Giving out the great spiritual treasures of India in exchange of means of material betterment from the developed countries had to be undertaken. Awakening of our countrymen to a sense of nationalism and social responsibility and channelizing the energies in serving the nation and working out their spiritual emancipation had to be done. Vivekananda applied himself, heart and soul, to this task. His ideas of spirituality, strength, love, service, unity, and harmony started creating a stir in the national and international levels. To turn this world, turn his world-moving ideas into practical action, needed a permanent means of reaching out to the nation's multitudes and the international community. Thus, starting a magazine was thought very essential by Swami Vivekananda, though he wanted real work more than just writing and talks. Swami Vivekananda's ambition in life was to set a machinery which would bring noble ideas to the doorstep of everybody and let men and women settle their own fates. Such was the involvement of Vivekananda in this task that he assured his disciples and supporters that he would write articles for it himself, send some money also himself, and even raise subscriptions for it. His devoted disciple Alasinga Perumal started the monthly magazine named Brahmavadin and strived hard to maintain it. Swamiji wanted a supplement magazine to this Brahmavadin to cater to the needs of students, young men and others with the same thoughts and ideas of the Brahmavadin. It was to be a scholarly research and also a commentary on the modern Vedanta as seen in the life and message of Sri Ramakrishna. Thus, Prabuddha Bharata came into existence in the year 1896. Sri B.R. Rajan Iyer, B.R. Rajam Iyer, a brilliant young writer and supporter of Swamiji's cause, started the publication of the Prabuddha Bharata and worked on it with great earnestness at Chennai, Tamil Nadu. Unfortunately, he passed away in May 1898, which was a bolt from the blue. The journal had almost stopped, but as divine providence would have it, Swami Vivekananda, at that time in Almora, talked about the continuing the magazine to Mr. and Mrs. Sevier, his disciples and followers from England. They had come to settle in India to work for Swami Vivekananda. It was agreed that Mr. Sevier would take up the managership of the Prabuddha Bharata and bear the cost of setting up a press in Almora. Swami Swarupananda, the highly talented disciple of Swami Vivekananda, was appointed the new editor. Thus, the ball again started rolling. The first issue of Prabuddha Bharata was published from Almora in August 1898 itself, in its own press, with only a gap of a month after it was discontinued in Madras. In March 1899, the press was shifted to Mayavati, which was the new site of the Advaita Ashrama in the Himalayas. The journal thus grew with great editors, taking the reins by turns and carrying forward the work through the last more than a century. Spiritual, religious, and cultural articles, along with the reports of relief and social service works done by our various centers, poems, conversations, class talks, editorials, and tales and stories, all these were the main contents of the journal. Sticking to its pure religio-spiritual character was a huge challenge which the journal successfully overcame in its long history. It is a matter of pride that the Prabuddha Bharata Press at Mayavati published the first two volumes of the complete works of Swami Vivekananda and the next three volumes from the press at Calcutta. In 1923, after carrying on the publication for 28 years, the Prabuddha Bharata publication section was shifted to Calcutta, while the editorial department of it remained at Mayavati itself. This was then under the able editorship of Swami Yatishwarananda. Swami Vireshwarananda later took charge of the printing. We thus see a long history of the Prabuddha Bharata spread through more than a century. In this 125th year of its publication, we hail Sri Ramakrishna, the originator of the Ramakrishna movement, the Holy Mother, the mother of the Ramakrishna order, Swami Vivekananda, the mighty instrument of his master, and all the disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. We also hail all the saints and great men whose life and teachings were propagated through this journal to the world at large, and all the philosophies and religions whose thoughts were disseminated. We hail all the writers whose contributions had sustained the journal and all the workers at the background whose labors have helped it. Many monks who were the editors and writers have risen to great heights in spirituality and occupied venerable posts in the Ramakrishna order. My humble good wishes to the present head of Advaita Ashrama, Swami Shuddhidananda, to the present editor of Prabuddha Bharata, Swami Vireshananda, and all others involved in this 125th year celebrations of Prabuddha Bharata. My humble prayers to Sri Ramakrishna, the Holy Mother, and to Swamiji that they continue to shower their blessings on this journal and make it a source of perpetual inspiration to the entire humanity in the centuries to come. Thank you.
Dear friends, Swami Vivekananda was a Buddha, an enlightened or spiritually awakened universal personality who could visualize India's glorious past and envision its greater future. Hence, Swamiji himself represents the idea of Prabuddha Bharata or awakened India. Prabuddha Bharata, Swamiji's dream journal, stands for this idea of awakening the world through an awakened India. The idea is that an enlightened India will enlighten the world. In a literal sense, Prabuddha Bharata means one devoted to the light of knowledge becomes enlightened or awakened. And in a historical or geographical sense, it means awakened India. This journal justifies its name in both these senses. Firstly, because it is dedicated to the light of self-knowledge, resulting in spiritual awakening, and secondly, because it stands for the idea of an awakened India in the national and historical sense. The journal and the meaning of its title, both are deeply rooted in the eternal spiritual tradition of India. Swamiji wanted Indians to become such Prabuddhas, enlightened persons, to transform this country into awakened India, so that the world would be awakened. For this, one of the methods that he proposed and actualized was the publication of journals. Prabuddha Bharata stands for Swamiji's vision of transforming India into a world teacher and bringing enlightenment to the human race. The celebration of 125th year of Prabuddha Bharata is dedicated to the numerous stalwarts who carried the burden of editing, publication and distribution of this journal for the last 125 years. The story of Prabuddha Bharata, a dear child of Swamiji, is a saga of sweat and toil of monks and well-wishers who have contributed in several ways. This momentous occasion is meant for remembering all those pious souls who, out of their loves for Swamiji and his mission, worked hard, sacrificing their personal interest for this longest-running English magazine of India. I offer my Sashtanga pranams and express my gratitude on behalf of Prabuddha Bharata and Advaita Ashrama Mayavati to most revered President Maharaj Swami Smaranandaji Maharaj for his words of blessing. I also offer my Sashtanga pranams to most revered Vice President Maharaj Swami Gautamanandaji Maharaj for his inspiring account of Prabuddha Bharata, which he called an epochal phenomenon, which will be a perpetual inspiration for centuries to come. I humbly offer my pranams and express my hearty thanks to the General Secretary Maharaj, Swami Subhiranandaji Maharaj, for recounting the glorious history of Prabuddha Bharata and narrating in detail the importance of Mayavati, the home of Prabuddha Bharata, and yeoman service rendered by the illustrious monks of our order. My humble pranams and thanks to Assistant General Secretary Maharaj, Swami Bodhasaranandaji Maharaj, who was associated with Advaita Ashrama and Prabuddha Bharata for 36 years of his monastic life, for his detailed description of how Prabuddha Bharata came into existence and has immensely contributed to the publication wing of Advaita Ashrama, and also inspired and shaped the thinking of many stalwarts, including Mahatma Gandhi and Dr. S. Radhakrishnan. I also offer my humble pranams and express my thanks to revered Swami Atma Priyanandaji Maharaj, Provost Chancellor, Ramakrishna Mission, Vivekananda Educational and Research Institute, Belore March, who said that the Prabuddha Bharata stands for realizing the ideal, bringing out the relevancy of Vedanta, while what other populist magazines do is idealizing the real. We are grateful to Narendra Modi ji, our respected Prime Minister of India, who emphasized in glowing terms that Prabuddha Bharata is not an ordinary journal, but an extraordinary achievement of Swami Vivekananda to manifest the spirit of our nation. We are thankful to two of our distinguished speakers, Dr. Makaranda Paranjape and Somnath Mukherjee, for effectively articulating the phenomenal mission of Swami Vivekananda of Prana Pratishthapana of Indian nationhood and the role Prabuddha Bharata played in this endeavor in presenting best of human thought and excellence for the last 125 years. In the end, I thank one and all for making the 125-year celebration of Prabuddha Bharata, which is of historical importance, involving the publication of a special issue of Prabuddha Bharata and organizing this special online event, a grand success. Thank you very much. Namaskar.